issued that really rare rebuke of what President Trump said yesterday as he was departing the White House to come here to West Palm Beach, Florida for the Thanksgiving holiday, when he said he wanted to file a complaint after the Ninth Circuit Court ruled against his administration's asylum changes. And now he's going after the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. I'm not sure too many people had the President versus the Chief Justice as something that was going to happen over the Thanksgiving holiday, but that's what we're seeing playing out right now on the President's own Twitter feed. Now, Jim, this seems to be a recurring pattern from the President with anyone who stands up to him or offers any criticism of anything he said. And clearly, John Roberts was offended by the President's remarks to reporters yesterday, which caused him to issue a very rare statement that we do not often see from him. Now, it's unclear what the President is going to say next, but it does seem to be John Roberts suggesting that the President has a simple misunderstanding of what it is that the judiciary is supposed to do. Jim.
Just remind folks that John Roberts is a Republican appointee, appointed by George W. Bush. Caitlin Collins in Florida, thanks very much. Let's go to CNN legal analyst and Supreme Court biographer Joan Biskupic. So Joan, you know this well. You're writing a book on John Roberts as we speak. First question, has a Supreme Court justice ever done this before, responded directly to a presidential criticism? And if not, why did John Roberts choose to do this now?
No, this is really different, Jim. It's not a general statement talking about the judiciary and its independence. It's responding directly to Donald Trump, parroting back some of the language that Donald Trump even used yesterday to criticize a judge based in San Francisco. And I am sure that John Roberts, who has been quiet during many of Donald Trump's other criticisms of the judiciary, weighed what would happen and wondered if he would be provoking the president. And sure enough, as Caitlin suggested, just 3 hours after Chief Justice John Roberts' remarks were made public, Donald Trump comes back and comes back with a warning that there might be more. I have a feeling, though, Jim, that as unprecedented as John Roberts' response was this time, he probably will not heighten this thing. He had something important to say. He wanted to defend the judiciary and the Supreme Court, too. And this is probably it from his side right now.
Yeah, I don't imagine that he wants to get into an escalating tweet
That's
battle
right.
with the president on this, Joan Biskupic. Thanks very much. Let's go to our panel now. Doug Hyde, if I could begin with you. So here is a president who yesterday refused to criticize a Saudi crown prince for a brutal murder, but today is laying into a Supreme Court justice, the chief Supreme Court justice appointed by a Republican. Why?
To ensure that that's not what we talk about. You know, there's been a lot of bad news for the White House. The uproar over his decision on Saudi Arabia, the issue of Ivanka and the emails. But instead, this is classic Trump tactics right here. He basically tries to pull a Star Wars and say to all of us, these are not the droids you're looking for, or the emails, or the decision, and make sure that we talk about something else. This is strategic and tactical.
With enormous consequences
sure.
for the status of U.S. institutions here.
I mean, this no is question
the,
about
the judiciary.
No, I wouldn't argue that it's positive. Yeah. And one of the things that Justice Roberts said was we should, and which is true, is we should be grateful for an independent judiciary. That is certainly the case.
Yeah.
But this is very, very tactical and very strategic by the White House.
Clearly, Chief Justice Roberts here is conscious of the reputation of the Supreme Court in a highly politicized environment post-Kavanaugh and years leading up to this. He's trying to defend the honor and the reputation of the court, is he not? And in the American public's eye.
Yeah. Yes, he is, Jim, and as well he should. The Chief Justice did and said what was necessary to say. President Trump can't help himself. Mm-hmm. So he will go after the Chief Justice or anybody else that he has to if he feels as though his power, his own power, is being threatened. But what he forgets, and maybe he needs another civic lesson, the same lessons that elementary school children receive about the separations of power. Yeah. And that really was what Chief Justice was laying out in his remarks, that there is a separation of power. And don't act, I mean, the president is acting very much like a tyrant, Jim, but this is not the first time. It certainly will not be the last time.
Fair enough. Kind of big panel here. I would love to hear your reactions to this as well, because it is truly extraordinary. One, historically, because we haven't seen a Chief Justice go head-to-head in this public forum before, but also for the effect on the respect for this institution. Anna, please tell me what you're thinking as you listen to this.
You know, as I listen to this and as I put it in context of everything that's going on, with Saudi Arabia, with the prosecution of Comey and Clinton, with Donald Trump dancing on the graves of Republicans who lost because they dared confront him or rebuke him at one point or another. He seems not to understand the basic makeup of America, of this constitutional democracy that is made great because of checks and balances, because there are three separate independent chambers of government that are supposed to check and balance each other. He thinks this is a dictatorship. He thinks this is he is an autocrat, and if you are not loyal to him, then you are not performing your job adequately. It also reminds me of when he tried to question a judge's ability to do his job impartially, the judge Curiel, in the case that ruled against Trump, by calling him a Mexican. Mm-hmm. Well, look, he will criticize and attack and undermine anything that does not go along with what his agenda is, with what is best for Donald Trump, with what he wants, that does not kiss his ring, among other body parts, whether it means attacking Republicans in Congress, whether it means attacking political opponents, whether it means attacking the judiciary. And this is where Republicans have got to step up and defend the basic tenets of democracy in America.
I'm glad you brought up the Judge Curiel comment, because that, I mean, seems like ancient history a couple of years ago. But again, saying that this judge could not be fair in a case related to immigration issues because he had a Mexican background. I mean, even the Speaker of the House at the time, Paul Ryan, said that that was the definition of racism. I just want to play for our viewers exactly what President Trump said yesterday that led to this public altercation, you might call it, with the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. Have a listen.
The Ninth Circuit, we're going to have to look at that, because every case, no matter where it is, they file it practically. I mean practically, for all intents and purposes. They file it in what's called the Ninth Circuit. This was an Obama judge. And I'll tell you what, it's not going to happen like this anymore.
Bakari, what do you hear when you hear comments like that from the president?
Well, I think the bold headline is someone who is consistently destroying norms and the fundamental tenets, as Anna said, of our democracy. I mean, in the past 24 hours, we had an individual who doesn't understand the independence of the Department of Justice and thinks that he can personally prosecute individuals that he wants to, including his political enemies. And now, I mean, we're talking about the fact that he wants to influence the judiciary in a way that has never been done before and should not be done. So I think that there's a lot to be said there about just the fundamental ignorance that Donald Trump has of the systems of government. That's first. But number two, to Doug's point, I do think that there is something to this in the attempts for Donald Trump to deflect and distract. And what I mean by that is we're not talking about the fact that yesterday the stock market lost 550 points plus. We're not talking about Saudi Arabia. We're not talking about these other issues that would be the lead issue of the day, but for the ignorance of these norms of the President of the United States. And to Anna's point again, I mean, when is Lindsey Graham? When is Ben Sasse? When are these individuals who claim to put patriotism over all else going to really stand up for what it means to be American? And a fundamental tenet of that is an independent judiciary. We don't have Obama judges. We don't have Bush judges. We don't have Clinton judges. We have judges who go up there and attempt to do the best they can possibly do within the bounds of the law. And the fact the President of the United States doesn't understand that is just more troubling than you can imagine.
And listen, this is very consistent with what we saw earlier in the week. Remember, just a few days ago, he was criticizing General McRaven for basically the same thing, saying he was a Clinton guy or he was an Obama guy, because this military hero who was willing to do what Donald Trump was not willing to do, risk his life in service and defense of this country and our democracy, because that military hero dared speak up and be critical of Donald Trump, he tries to undermine him by dividing it, by becoming, you know, he go again and again. What Donald Trump does is fabricate and create culture wars that don't exist. He tries to pit one group of Americans against another. He tries to divide according to gender or race or ethnicity or political persuasion. He does not understand at all the role of a U.S. president as a uniter, not even on a holiday like Thanksgiving. We should unite all Americans.
It's a good point. And I'm glad you brought up Admiral McRaven there, because, again, here you have the president Doug Kaya, if I could ask for your reaction here, coloring another revered American institution, the U.S. military, and a revered American military commander who was the architect of the bin Laden raid, as somehow a Clintonite because he disagreed with the president on something. In this case, with the president calling the press the enemy of the people. Now you have him calling any judge who rules against him, in effect, the other side. The trouble is that this undermines confidence in key institutions, right, that Americans, whose decisions Americans
sure
have to and want to respect.
Sure, and keep in mind, we had the Supreme Court go through a severe hit in its institutional reputation during the Kavanaugh hearings. Trump is taking advantage of that. As Bakari mentioned earlier, he was elected to bust norms. That's what he's doing, good or bad.
Mm-hmm. Well,
to the bad most of the time.
I mean, norms. But was he really elected to bust these norms, to take down institutions because he perceives them to be against him if they don't decide with him?
He shouldn't be, but, you know, Anna mentioned divide and conquer. That is the tool that the president is using, and he uses it very effectively, but to the detriment, ultimate detriment
of our
country.
And his base hasn't gone anywhere.
Right. Well, we'll see.
Not exactly a sweeping win in the midterms.
No.
we're going to have to leave it there. We do have time. We're going to come back to this in a moment because there's lots of news to cover here. Chief Justice John Roberts, not the only person President Trump tweeting about today. Then Nancy Pelosi's great week just got even better. The behind-the-scenes maneuvers that she made to change some view of the world. The president looking to go after those he sees as disloyal to him personally while letting the Saudi regime slide because some of perceived loyalty there. President Trump justifying his defense of Saudi Arabia after the murder of a U.S.-based journalist, as CNN is learning that President Trump has no problem punishing his own personal enemies. A source telling CNN that President Trump wanted now ex-White House counsel Don McGahn to ask the Justice Department to prosecute Hillary Clinton on multiple occasions. McGahn, according to the source, refused. The New York Times first broke the story of President Trump's request to prosecute not only Clinton, but also former FBI Director James Comey. CNN's Caitlin Collins has more.
Nearly 1,000 miles from Washington, President Trump's troubles have followed him here to southern Florida. As he hit the links with famed golfer Jack Nicklaus today, Trump faced growing criticism back home from Republicans and Democrats alike after he pledged his loyalty to Saudi Arabia, despite the grisly killing of a journalist.
It's not too much to ask an ally not to butcher a guy in a consulate.
That criticism coming from one of the president's closest allies on Capitol Hill. Trump responding to the backlash by thanking the Saudis, tweeting, "Oil prices getting lower like a big tax cut for America. Thank you to Saudi Arabia." The president making clear he's standing by his extraordinary statement and ignoring his intelligence agencies once again.
I think the statement was pretty obvious what I said.
But it's not just the president's treatment of U.S. allies that's coming under scrutiny. His conduct toward his political enemies is too. After reports revealed he wanted the Justice Department to prosecute James Comey and Hillary Clinton, following through on what he promised on the debate stage in 2016.
If I win, I am going to instruct my attorney general to get a special prosecutor to look into your situation.
It's just awfully good that someone with the temperament of Donald Trump is not in charge of the law in our country.
Because you'd be in jail.
The New York Times reports that Trump's calls to go after his rivals caused former White House counsel Don McGahn to outline for Trump how he could be accused of abusing his power and even potentially face impeachment.
I called my legal counsel, I said, how can a president tell the attorney general who to indict? I mean, it just doesn't work that way.
The president's orders raising questions about whether he's tougher on his political opponents than he is on an ally accused of murder.
It's just another head-shaking, head-scratching move that we see. And then, of course, coupled today with this statement about the murder of Khashoggi is absolutely stunning.
Now, Jim, people close to President Trump say he often asks, why isn't the Justice Department going after James Comey or Hillary Clinton? But right now, it seems that Republicans back in Washington are asking him the same thing about the Saudis. Jim?
Daily Collins, we often wonder when the president tweets that stuff, is he just tweeting? Well, it seems he was making formal requests to do that. Back with the panel now. Anna Navarro, if I could start with you, let's look at the list of the people that the president we've learned or has publicly attacked in the last 48 hours. Hillary Clinton, James Comey, Bill McRaven, former head of Special Operations Forces, Congressman Adam Schiff. All those people, among them Republicans, the Supreme Court Justice, but not Saudi Arabia. He gives Saudi Arabia a pass. Explain that.
Well, I can't explain it because I think we are in one of the most shameful moments in American history. And I hope more and more Republicans somehow are able to get the spines that they've donated to science back and act up and stand up and speak up against these abuses of power by this president. Look, I live in Miami. This is a community that is full of political exiles, people who have fled dictatorships and human rights abuses in places like Cuba and Nicaragua and Venezuela. And what we are seeing from Donald Trump is the type of things that these strongmen in those countries do. Go after their opponents, try to fabricate prosecutions, try to penalize and punish and make their opponents hurt. I'm not saying he kills them. I'm not saying he beats them up. But certainly, prosecution is a weapon that he would use to, extract pain from people that oppose him. It is so damn un-American. It just almost leaves me speechless that this could happen in America. And I remember when there was this issue during the Obama administration of where the IRS was going after some organizations that were conservative right-wing. And I remember the people in my party, the Congress people in my party, the leaders in my party, setting their hair on fire, speaking up, and demanding answers. They must do the same thing right now, because if not, they will and are the biggest hypocrites we have seen in American history.
But Bakari Sellers, Anna Navarro makes a point there about, here's Florida, state that has experience with actual dictators, and yet the Democrats just lost two important statewide races in Florida. And I know that's certainly not the only issue, Donald Trump, but clearly his name was looming over many voters' choices this election. Have the Democrats gotten the right alternative message, winning message, particularly as you look forward to 2020?
Well, I think there are two questions. One is a political question, and one is a moral question. I mean, the moral question is the simple fact that Donald Trump has been tougher on Jim Acosta and Abby Phillip than he has on a dictator, a ruthless heir to a dictatorship who has murdered an American journalist. I mean, think about that. He's been tougher on Jim Acosta and Abby Phillip than the heir to the throne in Saudi Arabia. That's first, and so it's a moral question. I think that's a bipartisan moral question that Anna asked, which we all need to ask ourselves, is, when are Republicans especially going to stand up and say enough is enough? And I think that we're actually giving the president of the United States slightly too much credit here. I don't think he's manipulating norms. I think he's flatly ignorant of them. I don't think he understands processes. I don't think he knows any better. I think he's, 70 years old plus, so we're not going to be able to teach it to him. But I just think he fundamentally doesn't know. Do Democrats have a message for that? I think Democrats do have a message. What we're coming off of is Democrats picking up 39, 40 seats in the United States House. We had a map that was not conducive in the United States Senate, and we had emotional ties to candidates such as Beto, Andrew, and Stacey, which lost. But now Democrats have to actually lead, and we cannot get in front of our skis, and we have to make sure that we show that we can lead and implement policy in the United States House of Representatives. That is the question that is yet to be answered. But I think this country has to answer, and I think Nina will agree with me, we have to answer a moral question first that's looming over this nation, black, white, Democrat, and Republican.
Nina, Doug and I were talking about this before we came on the air, how many Americans are driven by these kinds of moral questions, right? U.S. moral leadership, standing up for human rights, et cetera. In fact, there's probably many or not, hard to quantify. But have Democrats convinced Americans that these are key issues, that these are issues that they need to change for the sake of the country, not just for the sake of feeling good, but for the sake of the country's well-being?
No, certainly a good point, Jim, and I definitely do agree with Bakari. The Democrats now that, my grandmother used to say, you got to pay the cost to be the boss. Sometimes you get what
Steve
you ask
Brown
for,
said that too,
right?
Yeah.
He got it from grandma.
I'll take your grandmother over here.
But, But, you know, so sometimes you got to be careful what you ask for. Democrats do have the power in the House, and so they have to make a decision whether they're going to implement, investigate, or impeach, or a little of all of the above. But to continue to win over the hearts and the minds of the American people, they are going to want to see people who are going to lead and not just simply play in the political sandbox, but definitely do what is in the best interest of the people. That remains to be seen. Democrats won the election, but whether or not we are going to lead in a way that makes the requisite change for this country is...
Doug, just because we're running out of time, Doug, isn't there a test for Republicans as well? What they, you know, how will their words and their actions today be measured months or years down the line?
Sure, but the reality is most of the Republicans who lost are those Republicans who are most likely to stand up to Trump. Now, some of them, Lindsey Graham being a good example, has been very critical of Trump on this, where he typically isn't critical of Trump. But the other thing is politics comes at you fast, and Democrats are going to investigate on this and a whole host of issues as they campaign on issues not about Saudi Arabia, but on health care that really benefits them.
All right, stay with us. More to talk about what President Trump's lawyer tells CNN could, after the president submitted written answers to the special counsel, Robert Mueller, yesterday. Giuliani cautioned, though, that any questions about obstruction would likely go unanswered, argued that the president is protected by executive privilege. CNN's Alex Marquardt joins us now live. So, Alex, does this mean that the Mueller probe is coming to an end without that long-discussed presidential sit-down interview?
Well, Jim, on that question, the Mueller side has been very quiet, and in reality, the ball is in their court. And so what this round of written answers shows is that President Trump is being accommodating for now, but that may be tested by what Mueller decides to do next.
After months of legal back and forth and tense negotiation, Special Counsel Robert Mueller has finally received President Trump's written answers, responses to questions on possible collusion with Russia in the lead up to the 2016 election.
The written answers to the witch hunt that's been going on forever, no collusion, no nothing. They've been finished. Finished them yesterday. The lawyers have them.
Among the questions, the president's lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, said was what Trump knew about his son, Don Jr.'s 2016 meeting with the Russians at Trump Tower, as well as the president's own comments calling on Russia to dig up Hillary Clinton's missing emails.
Russia, if you're listening, I hope you're able to find the 30,000 emails that are missing.
But Giuliani is now warning that Mueller may not be done yet, saying he could come back with more questions related to possible obstruction of justice. It's not on the table, Giuliani told CNN, but could be put back on the table. Giuliani signaled they are willing to answer follow-ups within certain bounds. We'll consider them and answer them if necessary, relevant, and legal, he said, if it was something that would be helpful, relevant, not a law school exam. Questions about obstruction, however, would be outside those bounds, Giuliani said, because that would deal with the presidency and would violate executive privilege, raising the possibility that to get what he wants, Mueller would have to subpoena the president for an in-person interview, something the president's team has said they will fight, and the president himself now says is unlikely.
We gave very, very complete answers to a lot of questions that I shouldn't have even been asked. And I think that should solve the problem. I hope it solves the problem. If it doesn't, I'll be told and we'll make a decision at that time. But probably this is the end.
And Jim, Rudy Giuliani has also said that the special counsel's office has indicated that we'll respond quickly, within a week to 10 days, they say, to these written answers from the president. And in that time, the special counsel's office will determine whether more answers are needed from the president. Jim.
Alex Marquardt, thanks very much. Let's discuss now with our legal experts. And Jennifer Rogers, if I could begin with you. We've been talking, the president's been talking for months about how happy we would be to sit down across from the special counsel. That seems less likely now, and you have a sitting acting attorney general, the president appointed, who's criticized this investigation, who would have to approve of a subpoena for a presidential sit down. In your view, is that issue effectively dead now with Whitaker in that spot and these written questions now submitted?
Well, it depends on what Mueller decides to do. You know, it's at some level a strategy game. He'll have to see what he gets from the president and whether it's worth it to enter into what may initially, as you said, be a fight with Whitaker about whether to issue the subpoena in the first place, and then certainly a very protracted legal battle, which will go all the way to the Supreme Court, take a whole lot of time. And the question is, at the end of the day, you know, is the president just going to take the fifth anyway and not answer any questions? So Mueller and his team are going to have to sit down and just see whether this is a fight worth having or whether they want to move on with the loads of other evidence that they've been collecting from all sorts of sources on collusion and on obstruction.
And we should know that really virtually every close advisor of the president has said, do not sit down with a special counsel, knowing the president's sometimes difficulty in giving straight answers to questions like that. Ellie Honig, you have Giuliani making this argument here. That questions about the firings of James Comey and others, that the president and his team views those as falling under executive privilege, that this is something the president has the power to do. From a legal standpoint, does that hold water?
I don't think so. It's not necessarily a cut and dry decision, but Rudy characteristically was full of bluster, saying, I think we would win that executive privilege easily in the courts. I don't agree with that. The main decision on this comes from Richard Nixon in 1974, U.S. v. Nixon, when the Supreme Court decided unanimously that, yes, executive privilege does exist, but no, you may not use it here, President Nixon, because it's designed to protect military secrets and national intel. It's not designed to insulate a president against potential criminal liability. So my betting would be on Mueller prevailing if this were to go to the Supreme Court.
It's amazing how often the Nixon precedents come up discussing the current legal predicament for this president. Jennifer Rogers, the other argument you're hearing here from the president's legal team is that because the president answered some of these questions, they say, in the form of tweets and news interviews, that a subpoena, therefore, is not necessary legally. Does that argument hold water?
No, not at all. I mean, a subpoena is for trying to gather information from someone, information that you want them to give you, not just information that they want to provide you. So the fact that the president tweets, vociferously doesn't mean that they don't have questions that they're entitled to ask him about these matters.
Final question, Ellie. Is the president out of legal danger here, in your view?
No, not at all. I think he's still got significant exposure for obstruction. And look, the tweets and the news interviews, it's a perfect example of why Mueller needs to get a sit down with him or get him in a grand jury. He's tweeted on all sides of every different issue. Look at the Comey firing. He's tweeted and said publicly he did it because Comey mishandled the emails. He tells Lester Holt that he did it because of Russia. And so he's been on all sides of all issues. This is exactly why Mueller needs to pin him down. So, no, the president is far from out of the woods.
Ellie, Jennifer, thanks very much. Control of the House in January and vowing to investigate almost every aspect of his life. Sources tell CNN exclusively that the Trump Organization is thinking about beefing up its legal defense team. I want to bring in CNN's Christina Alesci in New York. Christina, the Trump Organization, I know you've been covering it closely for the last several months. It does already have a legal team, but they're concerned they need more help now.
That's right. That's because a Democrat-controlled House presents a unique and distinct risk to the Trump Organization. I'm told in the days following the midterms, the Trump Organization executives got on calls to discuss the potential barrage of investigations from the House Democrats. They reminded staff to preserve records, and then they discussed this idea of bringing in additional counsel, additional lawyers who have a specialization in government investigations. Now, that would be a big move for the Trump Organization because it's traditionally relied on a relatively small group of attorneys. And those attorneys are handling lawsuits. They're handling state and federal investigations. And they're pretty busy right now. If you look at the Trump Organization and what it's facing, for example, New York State tax authorities are looking into potential tax fraud. You have the Southern District prosecutors looking into potential campaign finance violations. And so that team is handling those things. They're pretty much busy as it is. Layer on top of that congressional investigations, and they could pretty easily become overwhelmed. That said, people close to the Trump administration organization did tell us that they may not need additional attorneys because maybe the Dems will go a little easier. Perhaps that's optimistic. Perhaps that's wishful thinking, because there is some political risk to the Democrats in going really hard after the company. Jim?
Of course, Michael Cohen, who knows the ins and outs of the Trump Organization, he has now turned state's evidence in effect there. I'm sure they're watching that closely. Christina Alesci, thanks very much. Back with the panel now. Nita Turner, if I could start with you. I know there was concern in the party and from those outside the party that the Dems will kind of overplay their hand here now that they've won the House. But I suppose you could make the argument that that's what voters elected Democrats for, was to give oversight to this president?
Well, Jim, absolutely. The Congress itself is supposed to be the check and balance on the president, but certainly with Republicans in control, that has not happened. But the Democrats do have to be very careful. Again, are we going to implement policy, investigate or impeach, or a little of all of the above? But the president can expect that his actions are going to be scrutinized, and now the Democrats have the power and the leverage to be able to do it.
So Bakari, let's look at the top 10, not the top 10, but the greatest hits of Democratic targets here. You got Nancy Pelosi. She's talking about going after the president's tax returns, but long been an issue here. You have Congressman Adam Schiff. He's talking about looking